It was a miracle that I got to this country. I did not select or choose to be left behind. My family was desperately trying to escape. My mother brought me and my younger brother to the Vietnam port and tried desperately to get on the boat, but we could not manage to get there, and then we eventually my mother had to put me in one of the area where she thought that I would be safe, and I ended up down in the bunker during the bomb that came down. There was two bombs came down from Vietnam area. One landed in the water and one landed on the Vietnam school, and I think that part of the blast that caused my hearing capacity to reduce. But in any case, I still think to this day the 9 years that I was left behind, 9 years under the communist regime, I pay the price. We talked about the lucky ones. I still think that I was the lucky one. Even without those 9 years, I don't think I could fathom or understand the death of suffering, the death of discrimination, the death of surviving. So even though the price was high, the price for freedom, the price to remain, to keep your dignity, although you were considered the bottom of the bottom in the population, I still believe those 9 years have taught me how to be human, how to be kind, and how to transform all mishaps into positive experience. I feel so honored to be here today and listen to all the stories. Stories that have been told before, but it's amazing to listen in person. And I thank you, Captain Jacobs. You made me cry today several times. You messed up my makeup. What an amazing journey that we all traveled, even though some are very different from the others, but we all end up here. One thing that I feel very fortunate that I was had a chance to learn the American legal system when I became an attorney. Learning the law and learning how the evolution of people who have paid their lives to fight for freedom and to fight for what we call human rights is so incredibly valuable. Twice people offered to buy me from my mother because I was half and half. My father's American at the Voltao Air Base, and my mother fell in love with him on the first night we met just because he sang the song, "You Don't Want to See to My Mother," with a beautiful voice. And my mother, all the story that she keep, anecdotes that she would tell me, when I had to work until 1 or 2 a.m. with no lights, no water, under the candle lights, and no food. Those days, the story that she told kept me alive and gave me strength. She told me stories such things like, "Oh, your father wanted me to have a good eyesight, so he made me drink carrot juice every morning." Or stories, things that he would mention, that if your baby turned out to be a boy, I would come back for you. You see, it's always a mixture between blessings and unfortunates that make us who we are today. I resented my father for leaving my mother, for leaving me behind. I resented him for years. And it's the day that I turned 17 when people told me, "Go back where you come from. Go back where you came from." And I have no idea where I came from. I just know that within me there is something very powerful, something unique that I must cherish. and use it as my strength. And so I walked into the government's office on that day and demanded I want to go home. And they asked me, what do you mean home? I said, I want to go to America. And mind you, by that time, there was no immigration stories. There was no Immigration Homecoming Act. There was nothing in that neighborhood talking about being immigration. But I asked for it. And I don't know where that came from. I think it's a miracle. Because when I talk about being discriminated against or being poor, you have no idea. You have no idea until you live in it. The poverty that we got is because out of fear, out of the problems of fear. My mother was persecuted, my mother's family were persecuted in the north because we were landowners. We were from Nanding, and most of the land in the Nanding countryside belonged to our family, and she was the only descendant that inherited that land. So she ran away at the age of 11. Fear and persecution, because many of our family members were very alive after what they call the people's trial. And my mother faced that, and she never wanted to face that again. So when words came that we're going to lose the country, oh my God, all she could think of, they're going to bury my child alive. And I was the enemy of the state. So whatever it takes, we had to escape. And out of fear, we ran and hide in the forest for a year. So you didn't have to buy my book later on to read what went through that year for me and what I had to go through in the 9 years afterwards. But the thing is, when coming back to Saigon, we were not recognized as citizens. We were never, because we didn't have the paperwork necessary to give us the right to purchase all the rations. Mind you, after 1975, it was the dark age, what we call the Cultural Revolution. So I was a guinea pig for the Cultural Revolution. Everything needs to be rationed. No books that coming from the past. All books were burned. And I remember one of the dramatic scenes that my mother forced me to do was burn my father's pictures. And I remember looking at picture over and over again before the flame took him away from me. Although I resented him, but still something told me that it was important, he was important to me. But to cut the story short, and I really want to say that you need to buy my books eventually because it's really cool. What to describe those years after was because of the intimacy of who I was and the fact that I was not having the right to be there, even though we lived where on the house that my mother built herself. They kept telling us, you must leave because you don't belong here. And those 9 years have taught me that persistency, resiliency help to survive all hardships. When I say I was poor, this is how poor it was. I was a teenager developing my body, but had no way to cover my body. I did not have money to buy the bra. And I only had two shirts and two pants to go to school. And because being half and half, I was developed faster than other of my friends. And so I didn't know how to hide my breasts. Ironically, I had breast cancer later on in me. But I said, these breasts really cause a lot of problems. And I had to use bandage and scotch tape. I don't know what we didn't call scotch tape back then, but I used tape to tape myself so that I don't show up and pray that it wouldn't rain, because when it rained, it would be really embarrassing. That's the price I paid for poverty. And when we say there's no food to eat, The ration was beginning, it was no rice, and then it came down, no rice, and it came down just corns, and then when it was no more corns, and it's yam. But meaning people with no right to purchase, we couldn't even buy yam. So we end up at the mercy of people who felt sorry for us, and they gave us the end of the yam. You know, the little things that people throw away. That's what I live now. So on the road trip in my 17, I demanded to go to America. And to my surprise, they say, here, here's the application, fill it out. My mother refused to believe me. She said, like, you do the crazy thing, it's going to embarrass even more. Because mind you, those days, you had to have a lot of gold to put up and to buy in order for your name to make it somewhere on the list. And for me, I was nobody, and I dared to demand to go. Well, guess what? I landed in America, in San Francisco, and I kissed the ground of San Francisco exactly on my birthday of my 18th, when I turned 18. If you don't call it a miracle, I don't know what is. And until then, I was still resentful of my father. How could you let me go through so much just to be me? And when I came here, I realized that they were talking about possibly maybe we should bring the children home. And I said, like, how did I make it? Based on what that brought me here? Because I was not part of the original refugees, because I had nothing to do. My mother did not work for the government, so how did I get here? And I found out it was the advocacy of the Vietnam vets in Washington. It was all those men who returned back to America and tried so hard to fight to bring us home. And it took us so many years to get the law passed. So when I learned that they chose to do one pilot project, and I was among the pilot project. So then it was my destiny that I said, I must fight with everything I got to make that into law. And we did. In 1988, President Reagan signed the law of Hemp Emigration Homecoming Act. And because of that, I realized all the years that I paid the price, it was meant for me to do good work. It was meant for me to understand what suffering means. It was meant for me to return to Vietnam and save those who didn't make it. And I can return to Vietnam in 1990. Back then, there was no relation between the countries. So you can imagine they treated me like I was some sort of spy. But at that time, all I've done is just to bring the emigration home. And that's when I saw the suffering was beyond anything I could imagine. I traveled from north to south and realized, oh my God, it was hell on earth. And then the Vietnamese communities here was critical of me. Why did you do that? And I did not care the criticism. I did not care what I had to pay, because I know I came here because of other people's love and care for me. Therefore, what I must do is to go back and help those who can't escape, help those who don't have any hope at all. And that's how I got into charities. That's how I got involved in the fighting for human trafficking. And that's how I became who I am today. And lastly, I just want to say, thank you, America. Thanks to all those who have hearts and have vision to fight for freedom. And I still think that the battle is not over yet. What we do, those of us who consider lucky that we made it, I really want to advocate and advise you and urge you, whatever we can do, we must extend our hand to help those who can't make it or who have no hope. And those, it doesn't necessarily have to be in Vietnam. They can be right here. They can be right in our communities. So again, thank you, and let's pay forward.